Can you explain the difference between, and tell me if you're doing it differently in trials or in research, one type of tumor that can be expressed that you can take advantage of is one that's within the tumor, and one is that you might be born with that mutation. So it's germline versus somatic. Can you just give us a 101 course on, do you use both of those types of mutations that someone's born with and the cancer, and when, how quickly can I use it? Because to me, if you're starting to use these, the moment I'm diagnosed with prostate cancer or I come see you in your office, I want to know if there's a mutation. Tell me if I'm right or wrong.
Yeah. Okay. Let me address you. Let me tell you what I do, but not everybody, even in my practice where we have 11 GU medical oncologists, people are doing it differently. But I'll just tell you my rationale. I at least always have a rationale to back up why I do things the way I do it. So germline mutations, let's start there. That means you inherited in every single cell. And usually, you know, if you think about the genes, there's like two alleles, okay? You might have inherited in one, but you need to lose the other before it really becomes functional or dysfunctional, let's say. All right, so we at our center tend to look early for germline mutations in patients. And the reason is Colin Pritchard, who's a laboratory medicine physician in our group, did some research and published in the New England Journal paper that showed that 12% of men with metastatic prostate cancer have inherited a germline mutation in a DNA repair gene that not only has implications for treatment, like with the PARP inhibitors or platinum, but it also has implications for downstream testing, cascade testing, family counseling. Because if you inherited it, what's to say your mother, father, daughter, son, siblings don't also have it? And these genes can predispose not just to prostate cancer, but breast, ovarian, and other cancers as well. And our goal is to identify them and maybe do early cancer screening in patients that are asymptomatic right now, but find a cancer early and save a lot of lives down the road. So it really has two potential benefits. So we're doing that early in anybody with metastatic prostate cancer. If you have earlier stage disease, let's say high-risk localized disease, the risk is probably a little lower, maybe 3 to 7%, depending upon what study you look at. I think that's plus minus. If you ask a geneticist who does research and whose whole life is this, they'll say we should screen anybody with a 10% risk or greater. Yeah. Now, it's not always covered by insurance, but I live by those numbers. So metastatic prostate cancer, 12% risk. Anybody with metastatic prostate cancer gets screened here. We have a study where if you can't get it covered by insurance, you can go online. It's called the Gentleman Study, run by Heather Chang. And you can go online, fill out 40 minutes of questionnaires, and get a free color genomics test sent to you. And you can do the spit test, cheek swab, send it back in. About a month or so later, you'll get those results. Okay.
And so this is the genes you're born with. So you're testing what I was born with at the age of 2, even though I might be 52.
Yep.
Right? Absolutely. So this is not testing the tumor, and you're saying anyone who has metastatic disease, you test them.
Correct.
Some way or another, right?
Correct.
That is awesome.
Okay.
Now, what about if my germline? So that's called, so anything I was born with, you're going to test if there's some kind of deficiency there. Mm-hmm. Now, what about I have metastatic or non-metastatic, I come see you, and it's not just my family's genes. What about my tumor's genes?
Yep, somatic. Okay. So somatic means you acquired the mutation over time and the cancer acquired it. It's a little bit more challenging because some mutations are drivers of the cancer and some are just bystanders. They're just there and they're not really doing anything to drive the cancer. It is very clear that when you look for these actionable genes and these things like DNA repair genes or mismatch repair genes where you can give immunotherapy to, that these things seem to be mutating and occurring later in the disease course. Mm. So the later you look, the higher your hit rate is when you test. So not all of my colleagues agree on this point. Some of them are testing them as soon as somebody has metastatic disease or metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer. I tend to test later because the hit rate is higher. And so that's kind of my rationale for that. I test the germline up front, which is probably half of the mutations there, and the other half is somatic, and I tend to look for that later. We're also developing better circulating tumor DNA methodologies where you might be able to get a liquid tumor biopsy and be able to, with a higher PSA level, over 20, maybe even over 10, we're having good success at isolating those tumor DNAs in the bloodstream and being able to do that sequencing and testing there. So,
it's moving toward, you might not even need to touch the tissue. You can just get it from a test tube when you draw some blood.
Right. And the advantage to that is you can get a real-time assessment, because a lot of times when people are doing testing, they're getting tumor tissue that's archival, might have happened from a surgery, 10 years ago or five years ago or something like that. Now, if the mutations are dynamic and it's not a static situation, and these are new mutations occurring over time, you're going to miss the boat if you test old samples.
Have you seen profound responses to the ovarian cancer drug? You talked about the profound, no pun intended. You talked about I didn't even think about that. You talked about this trial and people respond to Lynparza, which is normally for some ovarian cancer patients. There was also a response in a trial called Polo that was for pancreatic patients. So are you seeing, I want to believe you're seeing some profound results or to these drugs, because it's an oral drug, right?
Absolutely. It's not everybody, but, I think I certainly have patients that respond very well. I will say it tends to be patients that have BRCA2 mutations where I see more dramatic responses. Some of the other genes, it's a little bit more iffy. So I think the actual gene matters. And the question really is, there are still some patients that have these gene mutations that don't respond or that respond very transiently. And so there's some thoughts that maybe the way we're going about this by testing just for the gene mutations, maybe that's not good enough. Maybe we need to look at signatures, downstream effects that really show us that there's these, LOH signatures or HRD signatures, as they call it, homologous recombination deficiency signatures, that really take a lot of things into account to show, is the cancer cell acting like it's deficient in these DNA repair mechanisms. That might be the better way to do this. Right now, we're still early in this, so we're learning.